Welcome to Under the Radar, a show about independent iOS app development. I'm Marco Arment.
And I'm David Smith. Under the Radar is never longer than 30 minutes, so let's get started. So this summer, as most summers are filled with, there's been a a sizable amount of speculation and rumor mongering around what the new iPhones will look like this fall. This summer has been particularly interesting, I think, as we got way more details than we normally do from the HomePod firmware leak. But what I thought would be interesting to dive into this week is to talk a little bit, not necessarily specific, a little bit of maybe about what we're expecting to happen this fall, but I think more generally, an interesting discussion around making apps and developing apps and designing apps in a way to accommodate the varying screen sizes that we have to deal with. Because, I think as of right now, we have, if you're making an app that, say, supports iOS 10, so in terms of which devices are knocked out from it, you have to deal with the iPhone 5 size, the iPhone 6 size, the iPhone 6 Plus size. On the iPad side, there's the three sizes of iPad size physically. There's the Big Pro, Baby Pro, and then regular. Oh no, there's four there now because there's the new iPad Pro size as well. You may or may not have to also deal with different resolutions. I think we've eliminated on iOS 10 all non-Retina devices.
Yes,
I think. I think we finally got rid of the iPad 2, which was the one that was holding us back on that. Mm-hmm. So now we have 2X and 3X. And it's a lot of devices. And I mean, I'm sort of as a bit of like going back in history. Like I remember distinctly developing my initial applications, in a world where and developing an app for that then iPhone OS, it was 320 by 480. Like that was it. That was my entire world was fit into 320 by 480. Like that was the screen size for years. And it made a lot of things very straightforward. Like when I'm coming up with a design, I just have to see, does it fit in this screen size? If I'm doing localization testing, when I load up German, do any of my strings overflow and get truncated? All I have to do is look on one screen size. That was nice for a while. And then we got the iPhone 4 and that introduced Retina, which at the time was this genius way to make the screen better and in some ways show more on it. But as a developer, to do almost no work. The Retina transition was from a design perspective, fairly straightforward. Mostly what it just required was re-rendering some assets to be more detailed, but the actual, the layout and design stuff for a Retina and non-Retina was fairly minor. Maybe you could have gotten away with slightly smaller fonts and a few other sort of tricks like that, just because you have a bit more resolution, but overall it wasn't too bad. And then we got the iPhone 5, which introduced the tall version of that, basically, which again wasn't too bad of a transition because a lot of layouts tend to be flexible vertically. That at the time, anyway, you'd have a lot of like the obvious examples in like a table view, where it doesn't really matter how tall you make it; the width is the thing that is much more constraining, and you tend to design around. And then the iPhone 6 rolls around, and like it all just falls apart because now we have support for the old versions of all these old screens, and now we have these new screens. And then on the iPhone 6 Plus, all we have is the 3X mode. It's also really big. And in theory, though, I don't think it actually really... See, it didn't seem to really take on in a way that I think Apple was hoping for. It was supposed to also have a more common landscape use for most apps. And they were trying to push that a little bit with the way that that it was a phone that you could use in either orientation. But still, there's a lot of things that we have to deal with when we're having to navigate that. And I mean, I'm in the process of finishing up a big update and just got a whole bunch of new localization strings in. And it takes a non-substantial amount of time to go through my app in all the different screens and on all the different test devices I have to make sure it looks good in a variety of different languages. And there's that kind of practical side. But on the design side, it gets really hard because I often struggle with this tension between do I want to optimize my app for one size in particular? You know, the whatever the most common screen size is, which I think for me and for my phones is the, or for my apps is the 6/iPhone, the iPhone 6 and the iPhone 7 size, the sort of the small modern, the smaller of this, the two modern big sizes. That's what I see most of. And do I want to optimize for that? I think for me, it's about 50% of my users are on that screen size. Or do I need to, and just sort of like scale up and scale down the other two? Or should I try and be more flexible? And it's this constant source of stress. And then, of course, now as I start to think about this fall, and we get these wide reports of a new size, at least it's only one size, which I got to say I'm slightly encouraged by, that it isn't, there's not two new screen sizes, but there's going to be this whole new screen size. And it sounds, and this one sounds like pretty different and potentially with some kind of odd and interesting quirks to it, you know, in terms of it may have a cutout into the top of the screen, which you didn't have to deal with before. And it may be edge to edge. And so now you have to deal with margins where, you know, you can't go put your content all the way to the edge if the display goes all the way to the edge, because then you'd have problems with people accidentally touching things. And so it's going to be an interesting fall, but it's an interesting journey. And it's something that I think is worth unpacking, because this is not even to get into the iPad side. Like, the iPad is a mess in my experience, because there you even have, not only do you have full screen apps, but you also now have partial screen apps, and partial screen apps of so many different sizes and widths that, I mean, ultimately with anything I do on the iPad, it's just sort of, it's like, make things as absolutely fluid as possible, try and not worry too much about it, and just hope for the best, because that's the best I've been able to come up with.
I think it is worth diving into the iPad a little bit more, though, because it does relate in some ways to the realities of designing a modern app for multiple screen sizes. Because, you know, when Apple introduced universal layout, and I forget exactly when this main thing was, maybe like around iOS 7 or 8, when they introduced this concept of, like, you know, you don't have a separate iPhone and iPad interface anymore. Now you, like, use a split view controller or something like that, and you have just one interface that adapts itself to whether it's running on a phone or an iPad. And the reason why is because when you resize iPad apps in multitasking modes, they can get super skinny in one of the modes, and like where it's like the sidebar app. And in that mode, it basically is running a phone layout. But then if you make it half screen or full screen or two-thirds screen or whatever, then it'll adapt an iPad layout. So, like, you kind of had this need all of a sudden to make your iPad app be able to scale down to iPhone sizes and while running, and then scale back up at, you know, as necessary, which was certainly not easy to do in other ways. And so, you know, Apple bringing out these adaptive UI things actually helped that quite a bit. And then also Apple and the market push us very heavily to just use universal apps, to no longer do the thing that many of us did, you know, when the iPad first came out, of you have a separate iPad app and an iPhone app. Like, even in the store, they're separate apps. These days, the market and Apple are strongly encouraging people to have one universal app that runs on every size phone and every size iPad and can transition between the sizes while running. And this, if you try to do this, as I said, if you try to do this without universal layout stuff like split views and some of the size class based things that we have in the APIs, it can be remarkably difficult and not worth doing at all. And if you do it with the universal API stuff, it's still not easy. It's just less difficult. So because you have problems like you mentioned the 6 pluses landscape mode. Or, you know, I guess now the 7, you know, that the 5.5 inch screen landscape mode on the phone that kind of treats split views like iPad layouts. And so you have this little tiny skinny bar on the left and slightly less skinny bar on the right. That messes up universal layouts like crazy. You have different things like certain layouts will work in portrait on the iPad, but will bomb out horribly in landscape or vice versa. You have different, again, rotation itself is a whole different problem with screen sizes, basically, because the aspect ratio of your app can change and you have to be able to accommodate that in most cases. And so what this always leads me back to is, and I haven't always followed this advice. In fact, I almost never follow this advice, but it's something I keep in the back of my head, that you are really rewarded in this problem domain here by sticking to standards, sticking to UIKit stock layouts, stock components, not trying to be too fancy with custom stuff. You know, this was helped tremendously with the move away from textured bitmapped interfaces from iOS 6 and earlier, once iOS 7 came out and everything was basically just big white bars with text. And there wasn't a lot of like pixel perfect design anymore. That has helped this a lot, because if you're still doing pixel perfect graphics heavy design, you have to do so much more work for all these new screen sizes. And every time a new screen size comes out, you have to do more work. Whereas if you have a more visually simple and more flexible, more web-like layout in your UI, then when a new phone comes out or a new iPad comes out, you might not have to do any real work on the UI to get it to work. So in order to keep this manageable, especially for individuals like us, where like we don't have a huge team like Instagram does, although, well, they're a bad example since they still don't have an iPad app. But you know, we don't have a huge team like some of these big companies do that can throw 15, 20, 100 engineers at their iOS apps, and somebody has a team responsible for adapting to new screen sizes. No, it's just us. And adapting to new screen sizes is not something that we should be spending a ton of our time on. It's not a great use of our time. That should be something that we keep as simple as possible so we can focus on other stuff about our apps. And so we are very well rewarded by using stock stuff, by not altering it too much, by not customizing it too much, by not hacking around or relying on things being a certain size. You know, when the iPhone 5 came out, as you mentioned, like because it was mostly just like, well, it's the same width, but just add another table row. Like it was like 88 points taller, so that's, you know, two toolbars or a table row, basically, right? And it was very, very easy to adopt to that. And because most apps, you know, had the scrolling table view. But the ones that didn't, the ones that had, like, you know, the big graphical things, some of those apps are still running Letterboxd today. Some of them are still not updated. Even like the Tesla app was not updated for the screen size for a very long time. Like, modern apps that are being updated, like, or, you know, banking apps, like, they're famous, like, the reason they haven't updated in a lot of these cases, or the reason they take so long, is because it's hard for them. So the best thing we can do is keep it easy for us. You know, don't get too crazy with hacking UIKit or with making custom layouts that can't be very easily adapted to new screen sizes, new aspect ratios, new arrangements. But it also is worth, as you mentioned, considering what we should be optimizing for. You know, and in my designs, I try very hard to just optimize for the middle case, you know, for the most. You know, my analytics basically reflect what you said about yours, which is like about half the people are using the 4.7-inch screen size. And unfortunately, the other half is split pretty well between the iPhone SE, you know, 4-inch size and the Plus Phone 5.5-inch size. So I can't really lean one way or the other on that. Like, I have to design for the middle, but also be really sure it works on both sides. And one of the concerns I had when choosing my own device, even, is like when I was weighing whether I wanted to get a plus size phone or not, one of the downsides of getting a plus size phone for me is that my own use of the app would be skewed a little bit towards this large screen, and that's not what most of my users are using. And because I have a self-designed app, I think it's important for me to be using what the most of my customers are going to be using so that I can design it for that. So that's another consideration in here. But I don't know.
Yeah, because I think from an optimization perspective, like the only sane approach that I've really been able to land on is to optimize for one device, like, and that's what I'm making my layout for. And then in my technical approach, do make no assumptions about the size of things and make everything essentially scale up and scale down between the bigger phone and the smaller phone. So like optimize for the midpoint, just like you said, and especially because the mid it works out well, the middle size is the most used size. And so you can optimize for that. And then most of my code is structured such that you can give it any arbitrary height or width, and it will, you know, adjust the frames and the layout accordingly. But it's doing essentially just a dumb scaling of that. It's not radically changing things. It's not like when you go down to the small one, suddenly, you know, the controls that were laid out side by side are now on top of each other and it's taller. Like, I've never gone down that road. And instead, it's basically just have things scroll up, you know, sort of scale up and down, but not doing it in the way that it looks bad. And, you know, it's not rendering it at a small size and then, you know, squishing it up or down. You know, it's just making everything a little bit bigger and smaller. And then usually it's just a question of adding a few adjustments to make sure, you know, labels don't get truncated and so on. But anything other than that can just, in my experience, just become so unwieldy to try and keep track of. And it's just too much work and, you know, things to think of. And I mean, in some ways it reminds me of the way that I design watchOS apps. So in your watchOS, we have the same problem, but in a slightly different way, where, you know, there's two different watch sizes, you know, a big one and a small one. And in that case, I actually design my apps for the small size. And then the way watchOS is you know, geared and designed, it'll sort of almost naturally just expand out to fill the bigger 42 millimeter size watches. And it seems to work pretty well. Is it an approach that it's like, it's not perfect. It's definitely one of these things where I think you have to just become okay with the fact that you're not, you, it's probably impractical to have a perfect layout and design that is, you know, I mean, the more I go down the design road, I start to run into all these terms and things where it's like things are on, you know, 8-pixel grids, and like there's terms that you start to get into for like how people are being very precise in their layout. And it's like, I tend to do something sort of like that. Like, I'll do a fairly precise layout to make sure the aesthetics are perfect on that middle size. And then things just sort of scale up and down accordingly. And that works. I mean, and it's probably a fair place to confess, too, that I also don't use size classes in any of my apps.
You're not missing much.
At all.
Like, they're such a pain.
Yeah. Like, I mean, because size classes, storyboards, like the crazy advanced stuff that you can do in nib files now, like there's all the stuff that is theoretically possible to do there where, you know, when you open up a file in Interface Builder or an Interface Builder file in Xcode now, you see, you know, you can like look at this layout in this phone size, this layout. I mean, you have this huge array of options there. And it's like, that's just so cumbersome to me. And it's especially because those kind of files are so opaque. You know, I mean, I've said it before on the show. It's like, I just do all my layout in viewable layout subviews. And there's a bunch of math and it just sort of sits there. And as long as I don't hard code any values, if all the values are relative and parametric, so I can change them, you know, so I every now and then we'll have something where it's like on the small phone, you know, decrease the padding amount a bit more than you do on a bigger phone or things like that. But in general, like taking that approach where it's very straightforward and simplistic is the only approach that I found that keeps me sane, because otherwise there's just too many things to think about. And it's optimizing for something that I don't know, maybe for other apps, it would be super important. But in general, I find that a really well thought out, well conceived design for the middle case tends to scale pretty well up and tends to scale pretty well down. If it doesn't, that's probably an indication that it's a bad design in the first place, rather than the need to be like, okay, well, let's do this totally different thing on this size. And so that's the approach I take, and it seems to work pretty well. I mean, maybe if I, you know, spent more time optimizing it, it would be better. But I mean, the reality too is, like you said, it's hard because I've tried having like multiple phones so that I switch between on a regular basis. You know, in terms of, it's hard if you don't use a phone or a layout on a regular basis to really know what's going to fit, feel good there and be nice. Because as much as it's, you know, when I'm developing, I am constant, you know, on a regular basis, I'm cycling through which simulator I'm running it on or what iPhone I'm testing on at my desk. But it's never going to be the same as if I was actually using that phone on a day-to-day basis, using the app in regular use. And unless I am willing to do that, which can get complicated and awkward. And some of the things that have held me back from doing that before are getting slightly better in iOS 11 with the syncing of health kit data and things. But still, you have all the issues with like which phone is your Apple Watch paired to, or do you pair a different watch to each phone and just hope for the best and hope it all syncs out. But in general, I find like I'm just going to pick one, I'm going to optimize for it, and then that's hopefully just sort of good enough.
Yeah, because you have to draw a line somewhere. You know, as indies, it's like how much time do we have? How much money do we have for devices? How much of a hassle is it to switch between them? You know, one of the things I usually do is most of my simulator use, I use the smallest device. So I use like the iPhone SE for the phone, and I use a 38mm for the watch. And then on my actual devices, I have a 42mm watch, and I have the 4.7-inch phone. And so because about half of my design and development is on the simulator and about half is on the device, I get a decent blend there. I also, because again, like failing on a small device, I feel like is a worse failure mode than not looking great or not taking advantage of a big device. So my standalone testing devices, my main phone, which I do most of my testing on, is the 4.7-inch. But also on my desk, in a charging dock all the time, is an iPhone 5S. And so whenever I need to test something that I think might be slow or might where like I need to see how it fits on the small screen, like in my hand, not just in the simulator, I kick it over to the iPhone 5S. And there, I can't like take this phone outside and do anything. There's no SIM. I don't have any service on it. It's just an old iPhone 5S. But it is like a physical device of the smallest size that my app supports that is useful for testing. I don't have a 38mm watch just because I don't, my watch apps aren't that important to me, so it's not that big of a deal. I feel like, the simulator is good enough for that. And similarly with iPads, I don't have a 12.9-inch iPad Pro because, like, this is another area, really, you have to kind of figure out, like, for your app, like, if hardly anybody uses it on the watch or hardly anybody uses it on the iPad, you don't really need to invest too much in optimizing those. Like, the Overcast interface on the iPad is fine in landscape and pretty rough in portrait. And the main reason why is because almost no one uses Overcast on the iPad, and I used to optimize like crazy for it, and it was tons of overhead, tons of code, tons of testing, tons of bugs, and trying to manage the universal layout between portrait modes on the iPad. And so when I redesigned the layout for 3.0 with the little slidey pane thing, I kind of half-assed the iPad portrait version because almost no one uses it. And it was going to be a huge ordeal to try to fix that. So now if you launch Overcast and Portrait on the iPad, you get this giant expansive white space that includes the play controls and a little square thing above it for artwork. And to fix that, again, would be so much work. I just decided this isn't worth it to me. And you have to do that, with some of these things. Like, if no one uses something, that's just, that's something you have to do. But, make it usable, but it doesn't have to be pretty. This episode of Under the Radar is brought to you by Zojo. Zojo is a cross-platform development tool for creating native apps for desktop, mobile, web, and Raspberry Pi. Zojo currently supports macOS, Windows, Linux, iOS, and even Android coming soon. With Zojo, you just write one version of your app. So, for example, you can write it on the Mac, and then you check a checkbox, and you can have a completely native Windows version as well. And Zojo apps use native controls, so your app looks at home on every platform. So you'll be able to build apps 10 times faster, which will save you time and money. Zojo is great for everyone, from newbies to professional developers. It's currently used by over 300,000 developers worldwide, from students to Fortune 500 companies. So go take a look at their site and you will see just how many companies you know use Zojo. It's free to use and licenses are required to build standalone applications. So you can see for yourself, try it out for free. Go to Zojo.com, that's XOJO.com/radar to find out more. And listeners of this show can get 20% off any license with the code radar. Thank you so much to Zojo for their support of this show.
So the thing that probably makes sense to wrap up talking about is a little bit of expectations for what's going to happen in a few weeks when the new iPhones are released. Because I will say one of the things that does drive me crazy is when we're in a cycle like this where, we had WWDC and, Apple laid a few hints. Maybe there's a few little APIs that are kind of indications that things are going to be different. But then we spend the summer working, and you know, we're working on updates for iOS 11, and you know, just trying to be all ready. And then in the back of my mind, I know that I'm developing an app without knowing a big important aspect of how this will ultimately be used. That like, there is this information that exists in the world that I do not have, that I can't really make any choices about in the meantime. About. And so it always leads to this kind of this mad rush, in the sense that, you know, what I expect will happen is sometime in early September, probably the first Wednesday or the second Tuesday of September, there'll be an event. Apple will announce it. Like, hey, you know, show all this fancy new stuff on the new phone. It's why they expect it'll have a new layout. And then a few hours later, there'll be a new version of Xcode that comes out that includes a simulator for that screen size, and probably a little bit of documentation about how we're supposed to deal with it, if there's weird constraints or things that we have to do, the way we indicate to the OS that we're sort of ready for it, because typically what Apple has always done is when there's a new screen size, you have to actively opt into it. And if you don't, you are just run in kind of a compatibility mode where, you know, typically the phone will report to your app that the screen is whatever the sort of the biggest size that would fit inside of the you know, the new phone size. And so you kind of get tricked into thinking, oh, I can just run like I'm running on a plus size or a regular or a 4-inch size. And then we'll kind of have this mad rush. And then I'll probably be getting up in the middle of the night to pre-order a phone so that I can actually try this out in real life. Launch day, iPhone launch day will happen, in which case, you know, I'm frantically waiting for my UPS box, or if I used to go and wait in line at the Apple store in the middle of the night, but I think I'm getting too old for that. So I'll just wait around for the UPS guy and then just kind of like hope that, you know, grab the phone as soon as it comes. The first thing I do is which is kind of sad in some ways when you get this brand new phone that's super cool. Like the first thing I do is I run downstairs into my office, plug it in and just launch all my apps and see if, you know, see how broken they are. Because inevitably something's different than from the simulator. And this is kind of the cycle that I'm expecting. And it's a little annoying and a little frustrating, but, you know, that's probably what we have to look forward to for us in the middle of September this year.
Yeah, I mean, that's, again, it's like, that's kind of all we can do, right? And this is, it's going to be one of those things, like, depending on how different it is from what we've seen before, you know, like, there's speculation about this status bar notch and this possible function area on the bottom. And if these things are accessible to developers in some ways, we're probably going to have to do some work to adopt to that. And I would guess, based on how things have gone in the past, this is another one of those areas where if you stick with stock controls, you are better off. And Apple is kind of pushing you into sticking with stock controls. You know, for things like if, for example, you know, bars scroll under the status bar tabs up there, up top, or if bar button items from navigation bars get put in the function area, as some designers have speculated. Like, if that kind of thing happens, you need to be using the standard controls probably to take advantage of those. So, like, again, keeping things standard and not messing with them too much is almost certainly going to help you with transitions like this. So I guess if there's a theme to this, it would be don't mess around too much with custom layouts, because the standard stuff Apple tends to, you know, force us into over time to get the best stuff, or to have flexible layouts, or to not have tons of headaches. So with that, I guess that's the end of the episode.
Yeah, and I think we just look forward to a slightly frantic middle of September, but otherwise, hopefully, if we've been flexible enough in our designs and, you know, code, it shouldn't be too bad. I can definitely say that the transition has gotten easier over time, because I've learned the lesson to not hard code anything. You know, like, I remember distinctly going through my app in the first when I think it was the iPhone 4 came out. I remember going through and searching for 320, yep, all over my app, and like
Command Shift F 320.
Like finding all these places that I was hard coding values that I learned, don't do that, you know, pull it from the screen or pull it from the view rather than having a hard coded value. And if we've done that, we should be in good shape.
All right. Thanks for listening, everybody. And we'll talk to you next week.
Bye.